and if you're able to join us for this event, please, 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 this will be a fun thing for us to do on Monday. So check that out. A reminder that the church office is closed tomorrow, and Ash Wednesday is Wednesday, so we will gather for worship and the imposition of ashes Wednesday evening at 6:30. So make note of that. The rest I will trust you to read on your own. Friends, I want to thank anyone who participated in helping set up this room, from the setup, the decorations. We are grateful for Dizzy Doo to be with us this morning. I will remind you of this when we get to the offering, but we will pass the plates for our normal church offering, and then there is a plate in the back, and the money in that plate is designated as love to Dizzy Doo. So please share generously with them as you are able. With that, then, I think that's enough for announcements today, because we've got fun stuff to do. We have a designated... What? Oh, we have a video today. Oh, that's right. I forgot there's a video today. This is, it's really just over a minute long, and it's about the work Encore is doing in Turkey and Syria. Talked about if you wanted to give to Encore to assist with this disaster relief, just mark it as Encore or Turkey Syria, and the church will send the collective gift of our congregation. But I wanted you to know that there's already been movement, and Encore is already doing what it can in the region. Even if we aren't the first ones there, we're able to partner with other organizations to follow. So this is the blessing of what it means to be a worldwide church. We can do things like this, and we've got the infrastructure in place to just go. So, if you want to give to that, just mark your offering to Encore, and you will get a donation from the next few weeks. Okay. Mike has no more reminders for me. So, we have some ceremonial a king and a queen for our parade of saints this morning. Janine and Jake, if you would come to the front to lead us on our way through as we start our way through the parade this morning, because every Mardi Gras needs a parade. So when you hear music, lead us around and follow them. This is our job to participate and follow.
Well, it's not a break, so I'll follow. the Saints go marching in. Now when the Saints go marching in. Oh, when the Saints go marching in. Yes, I want to be in that number. Now when the Saints go marching in.
Let it be, dear Lord, let it be.
Others of them were not, right? It doesn't matter. All of us have the opportunity to be God, and to feel God's pleasure surround us, encompass who we are, not just what we do. So if you don't know what that thing is for you, I encourage you to experiment. Try things out. See where it is you might find the pleasure of God in your life. We're going to talk about some of those experiences for other folks this morning in church. So let's pray. Gracious and loving God, we thank you that there are lots of ways we can experience your pleasure, that we can celebrate your love with us, that we can feel your presence. Lord, help us to find these things. And if we know what they are, help us to keep doing them and to find you and be in relationship with you while we do them. But if we don't know, help us to keep trying. Help us to find you in this world. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Up next, Jesus Loves Me. Nice thing with it being up there. I can see it.
Yeah.
Where are those notes? I'll play it first time through with the band, and then we'll come in with the words.
Love me. elders, he had said, wait here for us until we come to you again. For Aaron and Hur, are with you. Whoever has a dispute, we go to them. Then Moses went up on the mountain, and the cloud covered the mountain. The glory of the Lord settled on Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it for 6 days. On the seventh day, he called to Moses out of the cloud. Now the appearance of the glory of the Lord was like a devouring fire on the top of the mountain in the sight of the people. Moses entered the cloud and went up on the mountain. Moses was on the mountain for 40 days and 40 nights. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and his brother John and led them up on the mountain by himself. And he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly, there appeared to them Moses and Elijah, talking with him. And then Peter said to Jesus, Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I will make 3 dwellings here, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. While he was still speaking, suddenly a bright cloud overshadowed him. And from the cloud, a voice said, this is my son, the beloved. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him. When the disciples heard this, they fell to the ground and were overcome by fear. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, get up and do not be afraid. And when they looked up, they saw no one except Jesus himself alone. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus ordered them, tell no one about the vision until after the Son of Man has been raised from the dead. The word of God for the word of God.
Thanks be to God.
Will you pray with me? Gracious and loving God, may the words of our mouths, the meditations of all of our hearts, be precious in your hearing this day. On this last Sunday before Lent begins, it's always nice to go into a season of fasting and setting aside with a bit of a celebration, right? And parties are way more fun than Lent. Doesn't mean that the rhythm of celebration and fasting isn't good for us, but we seem to enjoy these days a bit more than we enjoy a season of repentance and fasting. This morning, we encounter two of the more confusing texts that we see in worship. The text from Exodus helps to give us some context for our Matthew text, but they're both different from almost anything we've known in our own life. In the first we find ourselves among a person, and in the second, a group of people who have an encounter with God in such a way that it changes not only them, but the entire community around them. For Moses, it was the entire Jewish community who was changed by his encounter. And for Jesus, it starts as this small group of disciples who are changed, and then eventually, as the story gets out, more and more followers of Jesus are changed because of his commitment to God and his commitment to others to know that this God loves them too. Erica Brown Wood writes about what is different between the person who is having the direct experience and how the community encounters the retelling. She writes, one might note that Moses does not need the mountaintop experience from God in order to bolster his own confidence and his faith. Moses, after all, has been in a continuing conversation with God since the moment of his call. It's never stopped. So the mountaintop exchanges with God are meant for the people of Israel, God's firstborn son. So God pulls out all of the stops, right? We imagine that there must have been thunder and lightning and trumpets blaring, because you can't have an announcer without trumpets, right? There was fire blazing and thick clouds billowing. God's loving communication with the people of Israel assures them that I am who I am is with them. Now, similarly, we might point out that like Moses, Jesus does not need, right? Jesus does not need his encounter with God on the mountain to bolster his spiritual confidence or for him to enter into conversation with God, right? Like, We know this. Jesus doesn't need this. And nevertheless, God pulls out all the stops once again, right? The dazzling white robes of Jesus, the face shining like the sun, the appearance of Moses and Elijah. As in Exodus 24, the transfiguration of Jesus is meant entirely for the immediate benefit of Peter, James, and John, so that they may at least begin to understand the seamless relationship of Jesus to God the Father and unlimited power. But if we think about it, it really isn't all that strange that one person has a powerful experience and it changes things for others, right? Think about how a new restaurant opens in town and one person goes and has a great meal, right? They can't stop talking about it. So they tell their friends, they post on social media, they practically fly back, right? If somebody's been to a good place to eat, we all know it, don't we? And so the lives of the people around them change, right? Because their friends, their family, find a nice, great, another restaurant that they can enjoy, right? Find a nice, another good hangout. And then the owners and the staff of the restaurant are living a new reality with a busier schedule, right? Fuller tables, more people to serve. They need to order more food. The lives of the people around them are changed because of one person who had a positive experience, right? I mean, the opposite can happen too, but it's more fun to talk about positive experiences. Now, this is a smaller scale than having your clothes changed to dazzling white, right? Like, not the same scale. But I think it translates to a common experience that we're familiar how one person's experience can actually influence those around them. Now, when we're talking about our faith, about the God who created us, it feels like the stakes are a bit higher than a local restaurant, but that's fine. So Brown Wood continues. She writes, Moses' meeting with God on Mount Sinai is essential to the people of Israel as they face a 40-year journey through the wilderness on their way to the promised land. Likewise, the transfiguration in Matthew is essential to the disciples as they head into that terrifying time of the passion. Both texts are critical to us as we face into our own 40-day observance of Lent. The transfigurations of Moses and Jesus are meant to fuel the faith of their respective witnesses for the long and frequently frightening journeys ahead. Lent is not an easy thing for us to think about, right? It's just a dramatic shift that we will experience in just a few days. We don't even have a full week before we get to Lent, right? Wednesday, this shift will happen. And so it can be helpful in this moment to think about how these seasons work together, right? The people in our scriptural stories don't know what's coming for them. They don't know how the stories are going to end. They don't know what they will need to carry on. And they don't know that they're actually getting what they need in these moments so that they have the endurance, the strength that they need for these next journeys. Now, we know that we have some days ahead where we might choose to fast from a meal a day or from all desserts or from social media or YouTube or television in general or even from so many meals apart from our families. Like, whatever it is we choose to fast from, right? Now, in the first couple of days of that, we think, great, sure, I got this, I can do this, right? Maybe we even grab a Bible and we read some of those passages that Pastor Kathleen gave us last week to ponder about love and God's presence in our lives. But friends, a few days into Lent, the schedule picks up again. The needs sort of throw themselves into our faces. Our children have never stopped telling us what they need, right? And there we are, stuck between our very good intentions. What's easier? Building new habits and changing our behaviors are time-consuming endeavors. And friends, they don't come easily. But in those moments, we can remember back to a time when we were encouraged by Jesus, to a time when we celebrated together, when we paraded around the room as the saints of God we are. Right? We can think back to a time we felt close to God and in a deep relationship with God to help us get through those challenging days. Alan C. McSween Jr. tells a story of how he observed the world change in some difficult, in some challenging circumstances. On the day of Edith's death, he writes, the sky was that low, slate gray that usually means snow or freezing rain. Clearly, he's somebody who lives in the Midwest, right? The next day, the temperature hovered in the low 30s. All day, there was a light drizzle that froze on everything in sight. On that Monday and Tuesday, the whole world appeared gray and depressing. And then it happened. On the day of the funeral, shortly before the service, the sun came out with such brilliance that it was almost blinding. As we drove to the graveside, the road to the cemetery was lined with dogwoods whose branches met over the middle of the road. That day, every limb was covered with ice and sparkled in the sunlight like a million tiny prisms, each reflecting a brilliant rainbow of colors. It was as if the whole world had been transformed into a crystal palace. Even the weeds and broom straw along the highway were covered with ice and sparkled like creation's most precious jewelry. It was an unforgettable scene. For a brief moment, a world of dull, lifeless gray was transformed into what, to eyes of faith, could be seen as a brilliant foretaste of the new creation, a glimpse of a far greater transfiguration to come. We can find God all over if we learn to look with the right eyes, eyes that see the love in other people, eyes that see the importance in caring for our world, eyes that see new paths forward when challenges occur between people and countries. God is present with us, calling us to mountaintop moments, even in the present moment in our lives, asking us to go deeper. Marietta Atkins reminds us of an important scene in the Chronicles of Narnia series. She says, C.S. Lewis writes a final word from Aslan in The Silver Chair, which is the sixth book in the series. We've not read all of them. Here on the mountain, Aslan says, I have spoken to you clearly. I will not often do so down in Narnia. Here on the mountain, the air is clear and your mind is clear. As you drop down into Narnia, the air will thicken. Take great care that it does not confuse your mind, and the signs which you have learned here will not look at all as you expect them to look when you meet them there. That is why it is so important to know them by heart and pay no attention to appearance. Remember the signs and believe the signs. Nothing else matters. As we travel off the mountain, we have to take the knowledge we gained with us into the valley. When we are changed by an encounter with Christ or by the story of someone else's encounter with Christ, we must use that to change the world for others. It's part of how we share the saving knowledge that we have with others, and it's in fact part of how we remember it, because it's easy for us to forget too. By living it out and by offering it to others, it becomes harder for us to forget. It becomes harder for us to lose track of these experiences. So friends, today we celebrate so that we have the strength to endure whatever is to come. Amen.
Alright, up next we're going to do a tune called Bill Bailey.
Thank you.
give them to me anyway, because I already have them. This is how Satan will learn. So the joys and concerns that I know this morning, we have two preschool birthdays this week. Let me get them in the right order. Ryder and then Ashton will have birthdays this week. And then Heather asks us to be in prayer for Karen, who has cancer in her salivary gland. So prayers there. I would invite us also to keep Jimmy Carter in our prayers and his family as he is now entering hospice. So, with that, I invite us into a time of silent prayer.
Wait, I'm sorry. I didn't have a card, but Belkis was on a cruise and a helicopter landed on their ship and something flew up and hit her in the face.
Chair.
And broke her.
Chair.
A chair. Oh, maybe you know more. But she broke her some teeth and she's just kind of a mess right now.
Oh my goodness, is she home?
So she's home.
Okay. Prayers for Belkis.
Yes. Belkis Glover.
I don't know why that reminded me, but Karen Keighley is in the middle of a season of transition right now, so we'll be moving into assisted living facility shortly. But I think her son.
She's with Jim.
So just keep her in your prayers.
Karen also would like to still come to church if anybody looking for her.
So she'll be moved. The facility that she's intended to move to is in Gurnee. So if anyone is able to bring her at least occasionally to worship, she would be interested in that. So we can get you connected to her if that's something you're able to. No other hands that we'll do things old school meeting. Then we'll move into a time of silent prayer. I will lead us in a pastoral prayer to close us out. So let us turn to the one who loves us more than we can imagine. Show us how to live the joys and sorrows of life so that we know we are in rhythm together. Bind us to one another in ways that strengthen all of us and the presence of your kingdom on earth. Make us to be your hands and feet in the world, teaching and connecting in your name and on your behalf. We simply want to be a part of the group that changes your world for the better, rather than those who sit back and let things happen to them. Stir us to action so that those who are lonely, lost, forgotten, abandoned, hopeless, in pain, grieving, and many more, know that they are loved in your sight and by your community. Teach us to be mindful of the time where joy is abundant and the celebration sings. We don't ever want to let the opportunity pass us by to share joy and hope in the world. Thank you, Lord, for the gifts you offer, be they physical gifts, actual people in our lives, time spent with one another, or the prayers we share among the people who follow you. We ask that you would help us remember our mountaintop moments on days where we live in the valley. Show us your presence each and every day, no matter what we do. In the name of Jesus Christ, the one who was transfigured, who had his body changed, so that more would come to know that he was the Son of God, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
At this time, then, we
Creator, Redeemer,
Archer will play first time, and then the all of us will sing.
And sometimes we just need to throw a party.